Please join me in welcoming Richard Struse.
Idea guy. Yikes. So thanks all for sticking with us. Before I get into the meat of my talk, I just want to do three shout-outs for some folks who have done an amazing job today. First, our gracious host, Katie Nichols. I think she's done a fabulous job. Second, our soon-to-be-on-the-Today Show anchor, Jamie Williams, wherever Jamie is. And third, maybe a little less visible, but definitely very important and much loved, is Adam Pennington, manning the tweet station. So I just want to sort of reward you for sticking through with something that's really going to be easy to digest. I unfortunately have no cat memes, no magic unicorns, no ninja cats. But I do really want to step back a little and think about what it is when we start to talk about threat-informed defense, what does that really mean? And really, what's our call to action? Because I really think, you know, if this is about action, this is a community made up of practitioners, this is a community made up of doers. You know, so I'm the idea guy, in quotes, standing up here. I'm exhorting you to action. And it's really kind of an easy job because you all embody such an amazing spirit of can do. And, you know, whether it's Olaf and what he was talking about, or Alan was just talking about, John, what he was talking about, it's just an amazing amount of energy. And that's great. But how do we focus and challenge that? So about a year and a half ago, I started using this term, maybe it was 2 years ago now, a threat-informed defense, and it's not a new idea, and maybe I wasn't the first person to even actually use this term, but to me it was helpful. You are all practitioners of threat-informed defense, whether you call it that or not. But I thought there was some value in actually putting a name to it to actually help us as a discipline start to understand to communicate better with each other, and also help people understand the value and the extent of what we're doing, because it really is a different paradigm, right? I mean, Gary, in his remarks earlier today, did a nice job of talking about the evolution from a sort of a vulnerability-centric model to the world we're in today, at least in this room, and there's a lot of people who still need to catch up, and that's part of what my message is gonna be. But you've seen that great shift from, you know, vulnerability-centric, and if you're fully patched, you're good to go, to an understanding that that's not enough. So threat-informed defense is that recognition that just understanding what your assets are, just understanding that your vulnerabilities are patched, just understanding what your configurations are is critical. It's necessary, but it's not sufficient. And, you know, one of the cautionary notes when I go talk to groups of people about attack and threat-informed defense, I often try to be really, really clear, and I'd ask each of you to do this because I see you all as ambassadors of this community. And that is, you know, attack and threat-informed defense is not some sort of panacea. It's not some magic pixie dust you can sprinkle on an otherwise insecure environment and make it all of a sudden better. If your environment has single-factor domain administrator passwords, you have a flat, unsegmented network architecture, you have, you know, any number, you don't understand what your assets are, you don't need attack. You need some basic cyber hygiene and a lot of other things. Once you're at that level of sophistication, once you're tall enough to ride that ride, then, and only then, are you ready to actually start to go to that next level, to really start to get inside the adversary's decision loop and figure out how to be there waiting for them before they get there. So it's a critical message, you know. So when you're talking to colleagues and friends and coworkers, and they say, oh, I think I need the attack thing, just make sure that they're really ready. Just make sure that they really are tall enough to ride the ride. Because the last thing we want to do as a community is to turn into a hype machine and sort of a self-perpetuating motion machine where, you know, we just talk to each other about how awesome attack is. And I think it's awesome, but I think we have to be really responsible. So threat-informed defense is about taking the things in attack and beyond and using that knowledge systematically, and that's, I think, the key word, to understand and prioritize and define our defenses. One of the interesting things. If you ask me what are the primary, what's the primary use case of attack, you know, and we could talk about, you know, coverage assessment, we could talk about adversary emulation. Actually, number one is communication. I think attack fundamentally is a communications tool. It's a way of thinking about and describing and talking about what adversaries are doing, what you're doing in response to those adversaries, what a product can do, what your red team did, what your blue team found. And it's such a simple idea, but that's where the brilliance is, right? It's a brilliantly simple concept. And I think, you know, the size of this community and the acceleration of the adoption of the attack framework is testimony to the brilliance of that simple idea, you know, that was created here a few years ago. And so this is really the point. The fact that I can color a square, you know, pick out a puzzle piece, and if I hope you all appreciated the puzzle we had out there, and have a unambiguous, concrete, tangible conversation. Again, simple idea, but really powerful. So in this world of threat-informed defense, it's coloring in those squares to mean the things that are meaningful to you in whatever context it is. And so that's the other great thing about attack, is it can be used in so many different contexts, in so many different ways. And anytime you have a tool or an approach that can be repurposed and reused so many times, all of a sudden it becomes worth the investment. And I think that's the other thing we're seeing here, that attack has proven to be a great investment for individuals and for organizations. Is Shane Steiger here? Shane did an amazing thing some number of years ago. He created a game basically modeled around attack. And when I saw this game board, it's a literal game with like literal pieces, and I was so blown away by it. And that sort of inspired me to start thinking about attack as a game board, right? And if I'm an adversary and I'm looking at this game board, and from my perspective as an adversary, green means that I can land on that spot, I can safely move from that spot, I can do what I want from that spot. I want to play this game, right? I want to play this game every day. Because it's a low cost, low risk, low uncertainty environment. And the unfortunate reality is, this is the game adversaries play. I'm sure not in any of your organizations or here, but in far too many places throughout critical infrastructure and our supply chains, and certainly small and medium-sized enterprises, and even some larger enterprises, this is the game board that the adversary sees. Don't you want to play this game if you're the adversary? So that's something that must change, right? If we wonder why we are always playing catch-up as a community, I would argue that that's one of the reasons. Because the adversary has so much room to move, so much freedom. And they get to choose the time and place. They get to move wherever they want. So if we recognize that must change, we should start thinking about this as a game, right? We all like to play games. Games are fun. It's not work. So how do we start as a community? And we're already doing this today, but how do we really provide focus to our efforts to begin to change the rules of this game, to take those safe landing spots off the game board for the adversary? It's not something we're going to do overnight. And if any of you think you can do it overnight, please come talk to me later. But it's something that we can and should do. We must do. Our imperative, our call to action, is that we must begin to remove these spots. We have to do it every week. We have to do it every month. We have to do it every quarter. We have to do it every year. And we have to continuously be working to get to the point where that's all red. Now, are we ever going to get there? Probably not. But if you're an adversary, do you want to play this game? Not nearly as much as that first one. Can we go back to that first game? Because this is, from an adversary perspective, a high cost, high risk, high uncertainty environment where most of the time the stuff you try doesn't work. When it does work, you're then beginning to question, did this work because the adversary, because my victim wanted it to work? Am I in some sort of deception environment? You know, you start to be able to play with the adversary and manage the adversary. That's the world we need to be in. That's the world I believe we can be in if we continue the great work that this community has been doing, if we accelerate that work and we provide focus to that work. So again, I want to be clear. We're not going to get here tomorrow. We're not going to get here next year. But we can certainly all work to start to move in this direction. We must be as relentless as the adversary. Adversaries, they don't give up. They're advanced. They're persistent. And they represent a threat. Well, you know, we have to be just as persistent. We have to be advanced, persistent defenders, I guess. God, please don't turn that into an acronym. That's a meme. But as important as it is for us to be relentless, I think the more important point is that we have to do this together. And again, the great news is that this is a testimony to the fact that we are already doing this as a community. I just came back, as Katie mentioned, I came back from Luxembourg in the European attack workshop last Friday. And it was a really great, you know, sort of a similar idea, group of community members, all practitioners, talking about how they're applying attack in their environments, how they're using it to actually improve the state of their defenses on a daily basis. So we're already doing this as a community. We just need to do more because the threat is real and the adversaries aren't going away. So from my perspective, we have an opportunity to bring the best security teams from around the world, and you folks are, I think, are great examples of those best security teams from around the world, whether you're parts of, you know, large financial institutions or global manufacturers or healthcare concerns or IT security companies or professional services firms or ISACs and ISAS, whatever you are, you represent sort of that the tippy top of the pyramid of organizations and individuals who have the skills and the insights and the resources and sophistication to actually begin to make a difference. And then it's no surprise or coincidence that we're here at MITRE, which, you know, for over 60 years has been this trusted, objective, independent, non-for-profit place where deep thoughts are thunk and then good things happen as a result. And we believe that if we can bring these best security teams from around the world, together with the kinds of folks that you've been hearing from MITRE over the last day and a half, that we can actually begin to execute on research and development that will begin to deliver impact at scale that's in the public interest. So that's really what my focus has been of late, is to how do we take those community members who have the ability and the resources and the time and the expertise and the commitment to the public interest to try to focus our efforts so that we can deliver impact at scale. So, threat-informed defense, where do we go from here? What I can tell you today is stay tuned. Sometime in the next few weeks, you'll be hearing some more announcements from us about some of the really concrete actions that we're taking to move this community forward. If you're interested in the meantime, please come find me later on, or you can always reach me via email. But I want to leave you just with this thought. We can actually change the game on the adversary. We can actually, I can foresee a day, maybe it's not tomorrow, maybe it's not next year, where we're actually inside the adversary's decision loop, where we're actually beginning to win the battles, if not the war. So let's all keep doing what you're doing. Let's keep this community going. And let's remember to be as relentless as our adversaries. Thank you.